In what sense was she, Marian Evans, later George Eliot, an alumna of Bedford? Well, in 1851, by which time she was living in London and trying to establish an independent career as a writer of essays and reviews, she enrolled in a lecture course in geometry at the Ladies' College in Bedford Square, founded only a couple of years earlier. We don't have precise details about other courses that she may have attended, but they may of course have included classical and philosophical topics. But by that time, her early 30s, she had been working hard on Latin Greek, sometimes with the help of occasional tutors. She already had good French and German, and she was, of course, deeply read in biblical history and scholarship. She was perhaps the best ever mature student a college could hope for, however transient her connection might possibly have been. Why is she so interesting for us as supporters of classics today? When she came to write fiction from the 1850s onwards, one of the striking things to be seen in her writing is its intense engagement with Greek literature, and with tragedy in particular, sometimes explicitly, often implicitly. This is most obvious in the many quotations that she uses as mottos for individual chapters, but we can see it too in the ways she analyzes crucial situations. Here is what she says in Silas Marner about Godfrey Cass and his secret marriage. And if Godfrey could have felt himself simply a victim of his Dunstan's cunning against him, the iron bit that destiny had put into his mouth would have chafed him less intolerably. But he had something else to curse, his own vicious folly, which now seemed as mad and unaccountable to him as almost all our follies and vices do when their promptings have long passed away. A very nice combination of Aeschylus and Homer at work in the background of her imagination. What we learn from the diaries about Eliot's formidable reading program throws some light on the way she was able to integrate her study of both theology, history, and society, and science, with her study, a very intense study of ancient and modern literature. Sometimes in the library, in the diaries, she notes her reading in Greek of particular authors, at the same time as reading across a wide range of other topics and working intensively on her own creation. 1856-8, there's a lot about Sophocles and Aeschylus. And again in 1865, July 29th, read Aeschylus before breakfast. Second quarters, finished the Agamemnon for a second time. Homer was a constant favorite, often crops up in diary jottings over decades. In a letter from 1855, she describes her way of life with George Lewis at East Sheen as reading Homer and science and rearing tadpoles. It was always much more strenuously intellectual than this implies. An admiring American visitor in 1873, John Fisk, who'd written a book about myths, claims to have been quite overwhelmed by the power of argument, and her learning. I found her thoroughly acquainted with the whole literature of the Homeric custom, and she seems to have read all of Homer in Greek and could meet me everywhere. She didn't talk like a blue stocking, as if she were aware she'd got hold of a big topic, but like a plain woman who talked of Homer as simply as she would of flat irons. Eliot herself was explicitly not keen on the idea of being that most disagreeable of all monsters, a blue stocking. A woman, a monster who can only exist in a miserably false state of society, in which a woman with but a smattering of learning or philosophy is classed along with singing mice and card-playing pigs. Nor were her studies studies, a way of making up, I think, for not having had a traditional schooling in classics. There are some splendidly satirical comments in the novels on people who were none the wiser for having had one. For example, the unpopular bishop in Phineas Holt, who is all Greek and greediness. My favorite of her targets is Mr. Stelling, Tom's incompetent tutor in The Mill on the Floss. Mr. Stelling was so broad-chested and resolute that he felt equal to anything. He would by and by edit a Greek play and invent several new readings. He had not yet selected the play, for having been married little more than 2 years, his leisure time had been much occupied with attentions to Mrs. Stelling. But he had told that fine woman what he meant to do someday, and she felt great confidence in her husband as a man who understood everything of that sort. What seems to have been most interesting to Eliot, the novelist, about ancient literature, especially tragedy, was its combination of meditative intensity and the precise evocation of feeling. She has many reflections on guilt, responsibility, particularly towards family members, and compulsive action, which throws things into disarray. But she's always concerned to engage her readers with the emotional lives of her characters, so that the analytical passages, which work through imagery rather than cold theorizing, throw sharp light on the action. Here's an example from Romola. Our deeds are like children that are born to us. They live and act apart from our will. Nay, children may be strangled, but deeds never. They have an indestructible life both in and out of our consciousness. But despite all of her learning, George Eliot was not an earnest pedant. She has several memorable pedants in her novels, Bardo in Romola, or Mr. Casaubon. Mr. Casaubon says, I live too much with the dead. My mind is something like the ghost of an ancient, wandering about the world and trying mentally to construct it as it used to be in spite of ruin and confusing changes. There's none of this living with the dead in George Eliot, whose life and work are a compelling example of the extraordinary value that can be gained from reading hard and subtle books, which, though written by the long since dead, continue to be full of vitality and meaning for later generations, ours included, but we have to study them.